So you just stole millions of dollars worth of art. Now what? Hey, history heroes! I'm Tempest, and welcome to Time with Tempest, where today we're going to be talking about the most insane unsolved art heists. And if you like this video, please subscribe to my channel to see what hidden history I uncover next. Now, let's begin our story. Art can get stolen in lots of ways. Classic heists, inside jobs, and war looting are all just some of the ways that art can disappear for years, even decades. Some are destroyed, some are eventually recovered, and some simply vanish. Those are the works we're going to be talking about today because, hey, next time you're hanging out at your shady rich friend's house and they have this on the wall, you could have just earned yourself $10 million. So, let's get into the unsolved art heist, shall we? Perhaps the most famous unsolved art heist is the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum heist. Netflix even recently made a documentary about the case called This Is a Robbery, the World's Biggest Art Heist. And although I personally don't agree with their underlying theory, their facts are the most comprehensive and up-to-date of any documentary. The heist goes as following. March 18th, 1990, Boston, Massachusetts. 12:30 a.m. Two men dressed as policemen sit in a hatchback by the side door of the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum. Meanwhile, two security guards are working inside the museum. Rick Abbath, 23, who is a regular guard, although he had recently handed in his resignation. The other guard is Randy Heestand, 25, who is experiencing his first night shift. Abbath went on patrol while Heestand remained at the security desk. While patrolling, the fire alarms went off in multiple galleries. Abbath claimed he could not find a source for it and decided to shut down the alarm panel. He then opened the side door of the museum and closed it again. At 1 a.m., he switched with Heestand, who then went on patrol while Abbath stayed at the desk. At 1:20 a.m., two men dressed as police officers buzzed Abbath by the same side door he had recently opened, stating there had been a disturbance that needed investigating. Abbath let them in and radioed Heestand to return. At this point, they stated he looked familiar, and they may have a warrant out for his arrest, asking him to come out from behind the desk. He complied, and they handcuffed him as well as Heestand, who had just returned. They brought them to the basement, secured them, wrapped duct tape around their heads, and left to begin their heist. First, the thieves entered the Dutch room on the second floor, grabbing the Storm on the Sea of Galilee, as well as A Lady and Gentleman in Black, both by Rembrandt, smashing them on the floor to shatter their glass. Then, armed with knives, they sliced the paintings out of their stretchers. They then snatched a tiny Rembrandt self-portrait, Landscape with Obelisk by Flinck, and The Concert by Vermeer. Before leaving the room, they also grabbed an ancient Chinese Gu. Then, onto the short gallery on the opposite end of the second floor, the thieves snatch an eagle finial and five Degas drawings. The final work stolen is Chez Tortoni by Manet. However, it was in the blue room, on the first floor, and no movement was detected there during the robbery. The only movement was from Abbath, who had earlier made his rounds through it twice. After this, the thieves checked on the guards, took the video cassettes and motion detected data that recorded their movements, and left at 2:45 a.m. A few hours later, when the next shift of security guards could not make contact with the previous guards, they called the police, who discovered the guards in the basement and the missing artwork. This case has baffled experts for decades, not just because it remains unsolved, but because of the bizarre circumstances. The thieves passed works by Raphael, Botticelli, Michelangelo, and Titian to get to their stolen goods. And some of those goods were only worth a few thousand dollars, like the eagle finial and the Chinese Gu. Additionally, cutting paintings out of their stretchers damages them, and rolling them up really damages them by causing heavy flaking and paint loss. These were clearly not experts, and current theories range from amateur thieves stealing artwork to negotiate a deal to get their associates out of jail, to the thieves being hired to steal specific artwork for clients. Both of these theories would explain the bizarre choice in art. The one theory we can throw out is simple art theft, as this art can never be sold on the open market due to its infamy. And even on the black market, They would sell for well below their value due to the difficulty buyers would have in displaying them openly. Even though this has been an active case for decades, there have only been a few breaks in the case since the heist. Some hints are that they may have been in Connecticut and Pennsylvania at one point. Additionally, the FBI announced that they had identified the thieves and that they were dead. And then, of course, there's Rick Abbath, who has maintained his innocence for decades, despite the overwhelming evidence against him. Where the art is now is anyone's guess. Though most likely, some has been destroyed. Some has been sold to shady rich people overseas, though some may still be out there in someone's attic, waiting to be discovered. The reward for any information leading to the recovery is $10 million. And the statute of limitations has run out, so no one would be prosecuted for revealing the whereabouts of the artwork. So if you happen to see the paintings from the Isabella Gardner Museum, which I will link down in the description below, give the FBI a call. And hey, earn yourself $10 million. Hey, history heroes! Before we get on to our next heist, I just wanted to let you know about a new app Interpol created called ID Art. If you don't want to hear about it, you can skip to the next chapter. Anyway, with this app, you can upload or take a picture of artwork and upload it to the app to see if it's been reported stolen or has dubious provenance. And if it has been reported as stolen or dubious, you can make a report right on the app. You can also report an at-risk heritage site that you happen to stumble upon. Plus, all of Interpol's stolen works of art database is available to view. It's free to download on the Apple or Android store, and it's called ID Art. I've already downloaded it on my phone, and I highly recommend you do the same. Now, back to our regularly scheduled program. Now, heading north, we encounter the Montreal Museum of Fine Arts, the scene of a 1972 robbery that seems straight out of a Hollywood movie. On September 4th, 1972, just after midnight, three men begin a heist. One wearing boots meant for climbing utility poles goes up a tree next to the museum and gains access to the roof. Once there, he lowers a ladder to the two others to climb up. A skylight, which had its alarm disabled due to construction, was used as an entry point, and all three used an almost 50-foot rope to slide down to the museum's second floor. One of three museum security guards encountered them on his way to the kitchen, and after the thieves fired shotguns into the ceiling, he was made to lie down on the ground. The two other guards, hearing the noise, came running, and were also made to lie down where they're all bound and gagged. One thief guarded them with a pistol, while the other two tracked down paintings, jewels, and figurines. The jewels and figurines were probably taken due to their small size, and most of the paintings, too, were small. However, about half the paintings were from a traveling exhibition that was widely publicized. So it's possible that part of the reason the thieves targeted them specifically was that they thought they were valuable. They took the artwork to the museum's shipping department, but soon realized they could not pack the art and haul it all the way back through the skylight, as per their plan. So the thieves took keys to a museum truck from one of the guards and attempted to leave through a side door. However, the alarm blared as soon as they exited, and they panicked, taking only half of their stolen artwork on foot. An hour later, one of the guards freed himself and called the museum's head of public relations, who then told him to call the police. Once they arrived, it was discovered that 18 paintings and 38 other pieces were stolen. Like the Gardner heist, there are suspicions that this was an inside job, due to the thieves' apparent knowledge of the disabled skylight alarm. But unlike the gardener, these thieves knew that their stolen goods were too hot to handle. Within a week, a man called the museum's director and directed him to a phone booth where one of the stolen pieces of jewelry was located. Later on, an envelope was sent to the museum with pictures of the stolen artwork. The director asked for further proof and was instructed to go to a locker in Montreal Central Station, where one of the paintings was discovered. 1 month later, a sting operation was set up and an undercover officer posing as an insurance adjuster agreed to meet the thieves in an empty field to exchange $5,000 for one of the paintings. Unfortunately, a local police cruiser passed by right before the exchange and spooked the thieves, who did not reopen negotiations. No more leads have been found, and for now, the artwork, which includes works by Gainsborough, Rubens, and Rembrandt, remains missing. Now, while we've discussed two stereotypical art heists, it's time that we talk about the most prolific form of art thievery, looting. War and conflict creates an environment that makes it easy to steal artwork, And in the chaos, it can be difficult to locate and reunite the art with its original owners. And while it still happens today, the most famous instance of looting was during World War II. And, contrary to popular belief, all sides partook in the looting. There are too many cases to discuss, so let's talk about a few more famous cases, starting with Nazi Germany's looting. Just to give you some perspective, about 20% of art in Europe was looted by the Nazis, and the ramifications of that are still felt to this day. One of Hitler's objectives, besides becoming one of the most evil people to exist, was to establish an art museum in Austria. He knew the chaos of a war would further his goals by allowing the legal looting of artwork. Art was systematically stolen, usually from Jewish families, from every country they occupied, and divvied up into public and private collections. Degenerate art, basically art Hitler didn't like, was burned. The surviving art was stored in salt mines and caves to protect them from bombings, or was passed down through families with Nazi connections. After the war ended, the Allies set about to track down the artwork and created commissions to aid in locating them. Perhaps the most famous was the Monuments, Fine Arts, and Archives, aka Monuments Men, who had to contend with not only the Axis powers looting, but their own Allied powers. Tracking down more than 5 million pieces of looted artwork, they sent the art to collection points who researched the origins of the art and attempted to reunite them with their original owners, or at the very least, the country they came from. Artwork that could not be traced was kept by various organizations dedicated to further researching their provenance. Unfortunately, the Monuments Men could not track down all the art, and it's estimated today that there's still well over 100,000 pieces of art still unaccounted for. Additionally, looting by the Soviet Union resulted in 1 million works of art and 2 million books and objects being stolen and stored to this day in museums and galleries across Russia. All of this with the blessing of the current Russian government. Stolen artwork, whether from a heist or looting, is prolific. And every day, people knowingly or unknowingly contribute to their circulation. Provenance is forged, and buyers just ignore the strange gap in ownership during World War II. People may have a painting on their wall left to them by a relative who was a little too familiar with a famous art heist. And of course, shady rich people will continue to be shady rich people and display stolen art in their dozen or so homes and/or yachts. But this art is meant to be shared and needs to return home so some small comfort can be found, even in dark circumstances. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, please remember to subscribe, distribute your delight, or leave your calling card in the comments below because the YouTube algorithm gods demand it. Until next time, stay curious, history heroes.